We're talking about an aspect of prayer today, and we're going to talk about something that I've actually not ever preached about. I've taught about it in small groups and stuff like that. We're going to continue in our CrossFit series. How many of you were here last week for Super Bowl? That was such a good message. I can say that because I didn't preach it, right? So Super Bowl video that we showed, if you did not see it, let me convince you in any way possible to go to footballsunday.com and watch that thing. It's 35 minutes. So it'll be, for many of you, the best 35 minutes of your week, I think. It's a great testimonies, lots of testimonies from NFL players, some men and women and their wives talking about the power of God in their lives to transform them from the inside out, to heal them, right? There were some stories of healing there. And so if you did not see that video with us last week, I want to encourage you to go. It's footballsunday.com. And that's only going to be up for a while. So if you want to see it, go like today, you know, go in the next few days and see it. So I highly suggest that. We're going to continue in our CrossFit series. We're actually in week 6 of this thing. And today, like I said, we're gonna change a little bit of a turn, something that's not necessary. We've been talking about like workouts and exercises and things like that, because the concept of this series is that, you know, we want to be cross, right? Cross, the cross of Christ fit. And yeah, we're using the illustration of CrossFit exercise to kind of go with that theme and to keep us on track and just to do some fun stuff. So far, we've talked about a lot of different spiritual disciplines. The reason we're talking about this series is about spiritual disciplines, okay? Keeping ourselves healthy in our relationship with God, doing things, the things that we can do, okay, to help grow our faith, to help grow closer to God, closer to others. We started out, who remembers what our first week was? Does anyone remember? Should be the first thing always. The Bible, yeah. So we talked about the Bible, right? That's one thing that we need to feast on, right? We need to do that workout. We said RSM, what? Read it, study it, memorize it, okay? And we talked about prayer. We talked about generosity. We talked about evangelism. We talked about accountability, okay? So we talked about a lot of things that we do as Christians, okay, to grow our faith, to grow closer to others, to grow closer to God. And so today we're going to continue in that vein, but today we're going to take kind of a bit of a turn, to be honest. And we're talking about something, like I said, that I've never preached about from the pulpit. And we're going to talk about this thing called fasting. Okay, yeah, did you see his eyes just picked up? Fasting. Like, let me ask you this. Have you ever heard a message about fasting? Has any of you? Just a few of you, right? So as I was thinking back, like, I don't remember hearing many, many sermons on fasting. And so I was doing my research this week and stuff, and I read that this guy said that fasting was actually talked more in the Bible. It was talked about more in the Bible than baptism. So I started searching. I couldn't come up with those same numbers, but it's very close. It's like 50 verses on fasting and 70 verses on baptism. But I guarantee you, you've heard a message on baptism, right? But fasting, many of you probably not heard very much about at all. So the question was, well, why not? And so when I start asking why not, I start thinking, well, I'm going to talk about it. And so it's something we're going to do today. Now, let me just be clear. Fasting from food is not something that some of you need to be doing because of a diet. Because, like, Lindsay was here. She doesn't need to be fasting. She's pregnant. You know what I mean? You know, we've had some ladies that are pregnant here. You shouldn't be fasting. If you're a diabetic, shouldn't be fasting from food. So let me just put that out there really, you know, clearly, that there's some people that don't need to be doing that. We're going to talk about an alternative to fasting with food. So my little beard lit got caught up in the mic. That's weird, right? I never had to deal with that before. That's so weird. My little Irishman beard, you like it or no? Lori likes it. She tells me to keep it. I don't know if I like it. But anyway, so we're going to get right into the Word. How many of you are here for our Christmas series when we talked about Simeon and Anna? Do you remember them? So we talked about those two older people, right? And we read about Anna fasting in that series. So turn with me, if you will, to Luke chapter 2. I should have it up on the screen, hopefully. Luke chapter 2, just going to read really quick the section of Scripture that we talked about when we were in that Christmas series. Because we read about her fasting, And I was going to, at that point, talk about it, but I thought I really need kind of a whole week to talk about it, okay? And I wanted to talk about some different stuff there. Luke chapter 2, verse 36 says this, Anna, a prophet, was also there in the temple. She was the daughter of Phanuel from the tribe of Asher, and she was very old. Her husband died when they'd been married only 7 years. And then she lived as a widow to the age of 84. She had never left the temple, but stayed there day and night. And here's the important part, worshiping God with fasting and prayer. And we read that, and I kind of skimmed by that during Christmas time because I wanted to wait to really dive into what is fasting. I want for us to talk about it and think about it, because maybe some of you have a completely different idea of what the biblical picture of fasting is. So we need to define it. And the reality is fasting, okay, in this scenario right here, it's very much connected to worship and prayer. Okay? Fasting is not about just trying to diet. Okay? We don't fast in order to lose weight, in order to do a cleanse, in order to get God to do what we want Him to do. Those are the reasons not to fast, okay? Those are certainly not reasons to fast. But we're going to talk about what it is. It's a facet of what it says here. It's a facet of worship and prayer. What fasting is taking a time where you set aside and you're saying, I'm going to spend focused time in prayer about this specific item, this specific thing, whatever it is. Maybe you're looking at getting married to this woman or this man, or you're looking at changing a career, or you're whatever, big decisions. Sometimes they call for us to fast and to say, God, I need to be clear on this. And so I want to spend a whole day, 2 days, 3 days praying about this to make sure that, God, we're on the same page here. Okay? And so fasting is a way for us to stop most times eating, so that way we can spend the time that we would be eating in prayer. And then what happens when you don't eat two or three meals? What happens? Your stomach starts what? Growling, right? And so then we call that the prayer alarm. So when your stomach starts growling and you feel hungry, then you go, oh, I need to pray. And so what fasting is it's kind of a natural way to continue to remember to be praying for that specific thing all day long, okay? All day long. It's like a prayer alarm is really what it is. And so we spend time focused in prayer about something that's either bugging us or we're looking for guidance or wisdom or whatever. And this is, for many people, a very foreign concept, but biblically a very common practice of believers. Okay, a very, very common practice of believers all throughout the scriptures. Okay, so we're going to look at some of those really quick. But let me tell you what it's not. Like I said, it's not a diet. We don't say, okay, I'm trying to lose weight and so I'm going to fast today. And really the concept is that you lose weight, but you're trying to just let God think you're holy. Like, that's not fasting, okay? That is not fasting, okay? Fasting is not a cleanse. It's not a way, oh, I need to get a cleanse, right? So I'm just going to drink juice all day long and stuff like that. That's not what fasting is about. Fasting is about a way to pray. It's not a way to clean out your system, okay? Does that happen? Yeah, it happens. But that's not the focus of it, okay? The focus is Bible, prayer, worship, those things. And then it's also, some people say, okay, I really want this to happen in my life. I really want to buy that car. I really want to go to that college. I really want to do this or that or whatever. So I'm going to fast in order to show God that I'm serious. And hopefully I'll get Him to do what I want Him to do, right? That's not what fasting is about. Fasting is not a way to convince God that you should be able to do what you want. Fasting is a way to look at God, to pray to God, to hear from God as to what He thinks you ought to do about that situation. Okay? So it's a very intimate, a very common in the scriptures, intimate way to really connect with God. Okay? Because it's a continual prayer thing. And so I just want to be clear. These are some of the things that it's not. It's a focused time of prayer over a specific area, asking God for wisdom, guidance, asking Him to teach you, to show you what you're truly looking for, what you're truly needing in this scenario, whatever your scenario is. Like I said, could be choosing college, could be whether, you know, you're going to change careers. It could be, are you going to marry this person? Could be, do we go to North Carolina or do we go to Texas for the next job? You know, I don't know. There's a million things that you could in your own life fast over, but that's it's between you and God. So let's look at the scriptures where it's first mentioned. Fasting first comes up in Exodus. It's where I could first find it. It's in Exodus right here, and it's talking about Moses. If you remember the story of the Ten Commandments, you guys remember that whole thing? Moses goes up on the mountain. God's talking to him. It's all great, and he's up there. He's fellowshipping with God. God's etching the tablets, and he's etching the stones, the commandments. And meanwhile, right, the Israelites are down what? Partying. They're going crazy. Moses has been gone for a while now. They don't know what to do. Their leader is gone. He's up on the mountain talking with God. And so they make a little calf, a little cow statue out of gold. And they're worshiping it. Ah! Going crazy, having a party. Moses comes down off the hill. Literally, he's coming down and he's like, boom, boom, boom. And he sees them. And he gets so mad, what does he do? Yeah! And he smashes those tablets on the ground just in anger, right? So now, what does Moses do? Many of you don't know this story. He goes and kills a bunch of people, right? He goes and kills people. These people, they're not doing what you're doing, God. And God says, take them out. Like, we read the Bible, we think the Bible is all like fruity and flowery and stuff. There's all kinds of chaos in the Bible. Read that story. That's one of them, okay? People dying because they are not worshiping the Lord. They had brought in false idols. So he smashes the tablets, and then he's like, oh, right? And have you ever done that? You get so mad, you break something, you're like, oh, man, now I got to go buy a new one. So Moses is like, oh, man, he's got to trek back up the mountain, okay? 40 more days with the Lord. He's etching these tablets. And it says here, look at what it says here. It says, then the Lord said to him, this is his second trip up. Then the Lord said to Moses, write down these words, for in accordance with these words I've made a covenant with you and with Israel. So he was there with the Lord 40 days and 40 nights. He did not eat bread or drink water 40 days. Now that's intense. And he wrote on the tablets the word of the covenant, the Ten Commandments. Now in this fast, very obviously, this is a supernaturally empowered fast, because if we, humanly speaking, were to try to fast no bread or water, zero sustenance for 40 days, you'd be dead. I mean, this is reality. We know that. Okay, so God somehow in the mountain, in the cloud, was helping him live. Don't do that. Don't try to fast for 40 days, okay? Do not try to do that. That's not what I'm prescribing here. Go and just go out in the wilderness for 40. You're going to die. Okay, so let us know where you're at so we can go get your body. That's not going to probably happen. Okay, so probably not. So this was a supernatural fast. Okay, that's not what we're talking about here. There's lots of prominent leaders in the Old Testament and New Testament who fasted. Look at Nehemiah. How many of you have heard of Nehemiah before? A great leader. Okay, Nehemiah chapter 1. Verse 1 through 4, Nehemiah, this is the story of Nehemiah. Nehemiah is in captivity. He's gone. He's away from Israel. He's hearing about Israel being ransacked and all these people coming in and foreign countries and all this stuff. And he gets word back, okay? And this is his buddies have come back, and they're telling him what's going on back in Jerusalem. Here's how it goes. Nehemiah chapter 1. Sorry, I should have up on the screen here. It says, the words of Nehemiah, it's the very beginning of the book, the son of Hakaliah. Now it happened in the month of Chislev, in the 20th year, while I was in Susa, the capital, that Hanani, one of my brothers, and some men from Judah came. And I asked them concerning the Jews who had escaped and had survived the captivity and about Jerusalem. So he's asking, what's going on home? What's going on at home? He's not sure. He's been taken captive. He's serving the king at this point. And then it says this. And they said to me, the remnant there in the province who survived the captivity are in great distress and reproach. And the wall of Jerusalem is broken down and its gates are burned with fire. So it's chaos. It's chaos back home. Okay? And then look at verse 4. When I heard these words, I sat down and wept and mourned for days. And I was fasting and praying before the God of heaven. Okay? So Nehemiah hears what's going on. He starts crying. He's mourning over what's happened to his friends, his family, his nation. And so part of this fast, listen up, boys, listen to me, okay? Not to each other. part of what's happening in this scenario is he's mourning. So he goes to God, he says, God, heal our city. Heal our town, heal our people. And so he's going, he's trying to show God that he's serious about this. So there's multiple reasons to fast, okay? Multiple reasons. He's fasting in prayer to God to heal his land. And then if you know the rest of the story, the king says, you know what? Go, take resources and build the wall. And they build the wall. This is a great story. You want to talk about a great story in the Bible? Read the book of Nehemiah. It's really short. It's a great story. You've got all these people trying to oppose him. And he's like, nah, man, you ain't got that. It's just, it's a crazy story. It's a great story. So Nehemiah fasts. How many of you have heard of Queen Esther? Yeah, Queen Esther. Look at this. Esther chapter 4. She's fasting for protection, okay? Queen Esther's, the king does not know she's a Jew, okay? And all of a sudden, one of the king's men here says, listen, I don't like the Jews. We're going to figure out a way to kill the Jews. And the king's like, okay, whatever. He's just kind of going along with it. He doesn't realize that the queen is a Jew. And she's got to go before the king. And it's really important that she knows what's going on. Because if she goes before the king and the king doesn't call her, he can kill her for that. So she's putting her life on the line to go to the king to say before him, hey, don't kill all these Jews. Look at what she says here, Esther chapter 4, verse 15 and 17. She's talking to Mordecai, like her mentor, okay? Then Esther told them to reply to Mordecai, go assemble all the Jews who are found in Susa and fast for me. Fast for me, okay? Do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my maidens also will fast in the same way. And thus I will go into the king, which is not according to the law. And if I perish, I perish. Okay, she's saying, if I die, I die. We're going to trust God on this. We're going to ask God to protect us here. We're his people. He's got to save us. Okay, so she goes and it says, so Mordecai, her mentor, went away and did just as Esther had commanded him. If you know the rest of the story, she goes to the king. Okay, he doesn't kill her. He says, whatever you want, right? And she says, hey, man, there's this thing. You've done this thing, and the Jews are supposed to die. And he's like, okay. And it's just crazy. So you want to hear another crazy story? Read the story of Esther. The way God saves his people. And then this dude that's trying to kill him, he ends up making this gallows to cut all the Jews' heads off, and his head cuts off under it. It's awesome. It's like an awesome story. Read that story. But it says there that they fasted and they prayed for God's provision, for his guidance, to protect them. Another one. How many of you heard of Daniel? Daniel in the lion's den, right? We all hear that story when we're little kids. Daniel in the lion's den. Daniel's praying to God, praying to the God of the universe. And King Darius is, he doesn't really know what's going on. And so another one of these his government official says, hey, let's say that prayer is outlawed. And so king's like, all right, whatever. He doesn't realize what's happening. And Daniel says, yeah, prayer is outlawed, but I'm going to pray anyway. And then he gets caught. And so the king has to throw him in the lion's den. Right? And this is, look at this. Daniel fasts, but then also this King Darius fasts. Look at what it says there. Is it up there? Let's see. Daniel chapter 6, verse 18 says this. Then the king, King Darius, went off to his palace and spent the night fasting. And no entertainment was brought before him. And his sleep fled from him. This is another crazy story. If you know this story, the king has to honor his word. And so he puts Daniel, this God-fearing man that had been praying, puts him in the pit of lions, okay? And the lions don't even touch him. So he comes up and the king's mad and he's like, oh yes, God's saved him. And you know what? You guys that made me throw him in the pit. He throws them in the pit. And it says before they even hit the ground, the lions devoured them. Right? So God had watched over Daniel, protected him. Another instance there. So, as I said, there's all of these, at least 50 recorded fasts, recordings of the Bible talking about fasting, okay? Why don't we hear about it enough? Like, what is it that we're missing, or why don't we do it, or why don't we hear pastors talk about fasting? I think later on we're going to find out that Jesus talks about it being, it needs to be like a private thing and some of those stuff. You're not supposed to talk about it a lot, but that doesn't mean that we shouldn't learn about it and shouldn't do it. I think there's a lot of people that just like to eat. Right? How many of you like to eat? I love to eat. I was down in Valle de Guadalupe this weekend. I ate like my whole way through that whole valley. I mean, I had piglet, and I mean, I had so much. Oh my goodness, it was so good. Like, I gained a lot of weight in that little trip. I love to eat. And so people, of course, they don't want to fast. No one wants to give up eating, right? Especially when Girl Scout cookies come out. We talked about that 2 weeks ago, right? No one wants to give up eating. But it is a way for us to connect with God. Absolutely. It's one of those things that's kind of weird, you know, that you're not really sure about it. Doesn't seem to fit our lifestyle certainly anymore, but that does not mean that we're not called to do it. And in fact, Jesus, we're going to look here in just a second. In fact, let's look at what Jesus says about it. Matthew, turn to Matthew chapter 6. This is where we'll be the rest of the morning. Matthew chapter 6, this is still the Sermon on the Mount. Remember last year we looked at Matthew chapter 5, the Beatitudes. He's just continuing that conversation. We're going to look at Matthew chapter 6, verse 1. Jesus talks about fasting. He spends this whole kind of chapter here talking about what he thinks we ought to be doing. Okay? And there's this kind of expectation that we fast, as you see it here in the scriptures. Matthew chapter 6, this is what he says as an overarching verse. I just want to share verse 1 with you. He says this, "Beware of practicing your righteousness before men to be noticed by them." So listen, let me just stop right there. This series that we're in is about practicing our righteousness. That's what this is all about. Okay? It's about practicing our righteousness, praying, reading the Bible, giving, evangelizing, these things. These are practices that we do. We need to be careful about doing them in order to be seen by men. Okay? We're not doing this with a mask of religiosity. Okay? We're not doing this to say, look at me. Okay? We're doing this to grow closer to God, to grow closer in our faith. This is not about others seeing us do these things. This is about God seeing us do these things. And so Jesus, look at, he says, he continues, "Be careful of practicing your righteousness before men to be noticed by them. Otherwise, you have no reward with your Father who is in heaven." So we need to be careful. Okay? This is absolutely important. It's not about being seen or heard or acknowledged by others, because you will be acknowledged by others. If you stand in the courtyard of some place and you're praying, oh, we're going to talk about this in a second, people are going to see how holy you are, and some people are going to respect you for it, but that's all you're going to get, is maybe their respect. Okay? When we put on, I did this for 25 years, when we put on the mask of religiosity just to make people think we're better than we are, we're really not getting anywhere with God. Okay? We're not getting anywhere with God. Look at verse 2. Continue down. Verse 2, Matthew chapter 6. He continues. "So, when you give to the poor," he doesn't say, "So if you give to the poor," right? He says, "So when." Por eso, cuando, right? When you give to the poor, it is implied that you will give to the poor as a believer in Christ. It's not a question. He says, when you give to the poor. "When you give to the poor, don't sound a trumpet before you as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, so that they may be honored by men. Truly I say to you, they have their reward in full." This is what Jesus is saying. Don, you have the offering basket right there? This is what the Pharisees would do. Okay? "I've got my money. I've got my money. It's a lot of money. Everybody, watch me. I'm giving my money to God. Thank you, God, for what you're doing. Look at me while I give my money." That's what they would do. Blowing trumpets. "I'm so holy. I'm so generous. I'm so whatever." And Jesus says, "Nah, don't do it. Don't do it. Your reward, sure, some people are going to see it. They're going to say, yeah, he's cool. Most people are going to say, idiot, right? Just reality. You're not rewarded for that. So when you give, what's the next one? Let's move down to verse 5. Verse 5 says, so when you what? It's implied. When you pray, not if you pray, but when you pray. This is an implied thing. We're supposed to be doing this. So when you pray, you're not like to be the hypocrites. For they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and on the street corners so that they may be seen by men. Truly I say to you, they have their reward in full. These are the type of people that talk just like you and I. They speak normal. And then when it's time to pray, oh, most righteous heavenly Father, you know, all of a sudden they get this English accent, you know them, right? And they start praying, who art in heaven, and you know, it's a show, man. Do you know those type of people that all of a sudden get the prayer voice, right? And they start oh, God in heaven above that requires all things. I mean, it's just crazy. Like, they're just sounding great in their own mind. Okay, that's not what prayer is about. This is how the Pharisees would be. They'd stand on the street corners and, God in heaven above, praying is about you and God. Okay? It's between you and God. So pray that way. Don't worry about what others hear. Okay? It's not about letting others know that you're praying. Are there some times when we pray as a group? Absolutely. Okay? Absolutely. Keep moving down. Verse 16 through 18, same chapter. And he goes here, whenever you what? He doesn't say if you fast. He doesn't say, I'm telling you to fast. He says, when you fast. So it's an implied thing. We're supposed to be doing it. Straight from Jesus' mouth. When you fast, do not put on a gloomy face as the hypocrites do. For they neglect their appearance so that they will be noticed by men when they're fasting. So what is that saying? He's saying, listen, when they would fast, when the Pharisees would fast, when the hypocrites would fast, oh, I'm so hungry. Oh, like they wouldn't shower, right? They wouldn't do their hair, right? They just look so tired and weak. Oh, I'm so hungry. Kylie, I'm so hungry, right? Just hoping that Kylie asks, why are you hungry? Well, I'm fasting. I'm fasting to the Lord, right? That's, man. Like, clean yourself up. No one's supposed to know about that, right? It's between you and the Lord, is what Jesus is saying. And here's what's interesting. Now, let's continue. Let me finish that verse. But you, verse 17, but you, when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face, so that your fasting will not be noticed by men, but by your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. So it's implied. We will fast. We should fast. We need to be fasting. It's an implied command here. Okay? And when you think about it, it's very clear here that Jesus is saying a few things to us, right? And in all of these scriptures so far, it's very clear. He's saying, listen, don't put on this mask of religion just for others to see. This is about you and God. We're not standing up praying these huge prayers for people to hear. A prayer is between you and God. Okay? So talk to God like you talk to Him normally, like you talk to you or I. Don't come up with this flowery language to impress others. You may impress others with those words, but you're not impressing God. Okay? When you fast, it should be between you and God. That's what Jesus is saying there. It's not, oh, I'm so hungry, right? Oh, everyone look at me. I'm so holy because I've given up a few meals for God. That's not what we're called to do. And the reason that Jesus goes after these Pharisees is you remember the story of the rich young ruler? Remember that one? And he says, well, Jesus, I've done all these things. I've done this. I've done that. I fast twice a week. I read about this week. The Pharisees would fast on the second and fifth day of the week. They would fast twice a week. Second and fifth day specifically. Because what would happen in Jerusalem on the second and fifth day is the city market would be open. And so all of the people from outside would come into the city to buy their foods and their goods and things. And so the Pharisees tried to fast whenever there was the most amount of people around. so people could see how holy they were. Right? That's why they fasted on those days, so people could see it. That's why they prayed in the synagogues on those days, because there was the most people around to see their awesome, awesome prayers. And Jesus here is saying, it's not about that. He comes after these people. He's got a bee in his bonnet about these people, right? And he's saying, don't be like them. He comes after them pretty straightforward and says, do not be like these men. Okay? And so we should not be like these men. These spiritual disciplines are not ways to get recognized by KYMA, okay? This church has had multiple opportunities to be on the news. The news, the paper and the news have called us and said, can we interview about these things? Can we interview you? And I said, no. This is about what God's doing here. It's about what we're doing right here with the people. And you know, this is not about that stuff. We're not trying to be famous. We're not trying to do any of that stuff. We're trying to serve the Lord here. Okay? So this is not, we don't do these things to be recognized. We don't go and down to Rocky Point so that way the mayor can write us a letter of recommendation. We go to Rocky Point and we build houses down there because there's people there in desperate need. So that way we can preach the gospel to them. We don't do it. We don't do these things. Listen, those of you that are getting ready for college, you go to college someday, you don't come and serve at the church so that way your college application looks great. Okay? You don't come and serve at the church and go on mission trips so that way your application does those things, do those things help? Sure. But that should not be the focus, okay, of you serving here. If you got to do 40 hours of community service because you were an idiot a few weeks ago, you know, that's not the reason to come and serve the Lord. Can you do that here? Yeah, you can, but that's not a very good reason to do that, okay? It's not about those types of things. It's about serving the Lord, showing Him that we're serious about our faith. So Jesus throws out some ground rules there. He's fed up with these people. And He says, don't be like them. Okay? So the question is, are we only supposed to fast privately, singularly? Do we only fast in our life by ourselves with no one knowing? And the answer biblically to that is no, because there's other examples of groups of people. Okay, turn to Acts chapter 13. This is the last section of scripture we're going to look at. Acts chapter 13. There were multiple groups of people. Remember Esther? Esther says, tell everyone to fast. Tell everyone to fast for me. Okay? All throughout the scripture, there's groups of people fasting together. So it's done privately, but then it's also done in groups as well. Okay? And so this is a great example of a church that's coming together, fasting before the Lord to figure out where they're supposed to go, where they're supposed to move, what are they supposed to do. Look at Acts chapter 13, verse 1 through 13, through 3, sorry. Acts chapter 13, verse 1. Now this church that we're going to talk about in Antioch, it's really our mother church, okay? This is the church that planted our church thousands of years ago, okay? Because they said, we've got all of these believers together, now how are we going to go and share with the world this message of Jesus? And they said, let's go. And let's start going out two by two. Let's go out and let's go start talking to people about Jesus. Let's start talking about people about Jesus and Jesus and Jesus. And now we're here because of this church in Antioch. Okay? This is our mother church here. Check this out. Now there were at Antioch in the church that was there prophets and teachers. I begin to name some of them. Barnabas and Simeon, who was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene and Manaen, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch. And Saul, who we know as Paul, okay, this is before his name had been changed in the scriptures here. And while they were ministering to the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I've called them. Then when they had fasted and prayed, again, fasting and prayer go together. They always go together, okay? You should be doing both at the same time. That's the whole point of fasting. So when they had fasted and prayed, they laid their hands on them and they sent them away. The church at Antioch really was like the central hub of missions, spreading the gospel all throughout the world from this little church right here. And it's from this church that you get all these other little churches. You know, all these other Bible books of the Bible, 1 Corinthians, Thessalonians, all of those books, those names of churches, they all came because of these guys right here, going out and spreading the gospel. Okay? And so they were at a point where they said, how are we going to spread the gospel? How are we going to do what Jesus has told us to do, to go and make disciples of all nations? And so they say to God, they say, God, we are serious. We want to do what you want us to do. We need some wisdom. We need some guidance. So we're going to come together and we're going to fast and we're going to pray together on what you want us to do as a church to reach the nations. Okay? Let me tell you right now, this is where Ekklesia, this church, is at right now. We're in the exact same spot as this church at Antioch, because as a leadership team, we're trying to figure out, how do we reach the people right around us? How do we reach the people that live right there, and right there, and right there, and right there? And so we as a leadership team are going to God in prayer, saying, God, give us direction and guidance for how to reach the nations. How do we reach the people around us? And that's what we're doing on these prayer nights, Thursday night, Wednesday night. We're praying together, asking for God's wisdom on where we're supposed to move, where we're supposed to go, what are we supposed to do to reach the people for Jesus, okay? And so this is very real for us at this church right now. In this point in time, this is very, very real for us. We're asking God together, show us your plan. Who are we supposed to send out like Barnabas and Saul, right? Are we supposed to send some people out to go do something else? Are we supposed to send out fires? We've got a lot of ideas. And we're asking God collectively to come and give us his direction. And so my challenge to you, and I talked to the leaders about this the other night, I want for us as a church, for those of you that are interested, I want for us to do a church-wide, if you can, fast on March 4th, which is a Saturday, okay? And if you can't do it that day, that's great. If you can't do fast because of your diet, you know, or whatever, we understand that you can fast in other ways, which I'll talk about in a second. But my prayer is that the people of this church will fast together on March 4th, and here's why I say that. We're looking at, here at Ekklesia, we're looking at doing some things to reach our neighbors. We're talking and have been praying about for a while starting a breakfast, a free breakfast every single Sunday morning. Because as when we do meals here, a lot of people come. And so we're thinking if we do a free breakfast here in connection with the power packs that we give out, we may have a lot of people walking from all over the place to do that. That's a huge task for us. We're also thinking about and talking about starting another service at another school like once a month over on 20th Street, like Pueblo or Valley Horizon or something like that. We're also talking about maybe trying to do both at the same time. We're not really sure. We know for sure that we need to take the next level, the next step in reaching more people because, listen, this place will hold 600. Look, it says right there, 595 person capacity, right? Right now, we have about 60, okay? So we can do 10 times what we have right now. And that's our prayer and vision, that this church would grow. Is it going to be really difficult? Oh, yeah, for sure. Are we going to be able to grow this church to 600 just by making good plans and putting out good flyers? No. We want to seek God's wisdom in these things. And so my prayer is that we're going to pray for the next few weeks, pray over these things together on Wednesday evening at 8 o'clock, and then also fast, 24-hour fast, so the fast would start on Saturday, and then on Sunday, March 5th, we're going to do communion together. So the fast will end as we take the bread and the juice together, and so for 24 hours, that would be your first food. I've done several fasts like that to where you end the fast with communion. It's a great way to kind of solidify what God has done in your heart over the last 24 hours. And so I'm going to talk about that for the next few weeks. I'm going to challenge you to do it. It may be something way outside your comfort zone, but I'm going to challenge you to take that step and take that step of obedience to Him. and see what God does in our congregation, because we need His wisdom and guidance to do some of this stuff. There are other examples all throughout the scriptures of people fasting. Ekklesia, when we named this church before we were even a church, the group, the core team, we fasted together to choose the name Ekklesia. Okay? We wanted to be sure this was God's name for this church. We didn't want it just to be a weird name. Most people are like, what is that, right? We fasted over that decision. There's like a dozen of us that fasted over that decision. Personally, I fasted over when I left the Border Patrol to come into ministry, and like, it was a huge step for me. I fasted for like 3 days. My wife and I fasted there for several days on that decision. I fasted at Oasis years ago. There was a bunch of chaos going on there, and I had to decide whether I was going to stay or leave. I fasted for 3 days over that decision. The decision to plant this church, that was a big decision for Lori and I. So we fasted over that decision. So I've fasted in my life no longer than 3 days. I've only ever done the longest is a 3-day fast. But I'm asking us to do a 1-day fast together on March 4th. And there are alternatives. So if you can't fast from food, imagine fasting from your cell phone. Whoa, right? Like, how many of you all day long are like looking at it? Bing, 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 right? Like, imagine fasting from your cell phone. Would that be horrible for you or what? Right? There's some of you that can't fast in food. That's okay. All fasting is a way for you to be constantly reminded to be praying about that thing that you're praying about, okay? So maybe your fast is you can't fast from eating, but the whole time you're eating, you're praying, okay? That can happen too. Maybe your fast is you're going to decide to not watch TV, and for you figure out how much TV you watch in a day, which is for most Americans like 2.5 hours a day of TV. So you're going to say, I'm going to set aside today 2.5 hours to pray. Fasting is just a way to have focused prayer over one topic, okay? And so that's what we want to do on that day. And we're praying that God will use this as a mighty thing in our church. So that's my challenge to you. And so let's practice. Let's not be people that hear messages like this. Yeah, I really ought to read my Bible. You're right, Pastor. I ought to read my Bible. And you agree with me, and then you don't read your Bible, right? You don't do anything about it. Yeah, we really ought to pray, Pastor. You're right. Amen. We ought to pray. And then you don't pray, right? Let's not be people like that. If we believe that we ought to be doing these things that we're talking about in this series, let's actually do them. I bet you. I mean, I can almost guarantee. I can't guarantee a lot of stuff, but I can pretty much guarantee that if these things we've talked about in this series, if we will do them, this place will change. Okay? This place will absolutely change if we do these things that we've talked about. Okay? Reading our Bible, praying, being generous, sharing our story. We'd grow to 600 very shortly if we all of us did that. And it's just reality, okay? It's just reality. So let's be people that do those things. Worship team.